Today's guest speakers are Margaret, Lovesky, and Emily Cooke. Margaret Lovesky received her bachelor's of biology and dietetics from the University of Rhode Island in 2003, and she completed her dietetic internship at Brigham and Women's Hospital in 2004. She is currently working on her master's degree in public health at Boston University. She is a lead dietitian in Dr. Ludwig's obesity research group. Emily Cooke received her bachelor's in nutritional sciences from the University of New Hampshire in 2004. She completed her dietetic internship at Brigham and Women's Hospital in 2007. In between undergrad and her internship, Emily spent time overseas in Azerbaijan teaching English as a second language. She hopes to eventually utilize her nutrition knowledge and expertise abroad. Their topic today is getting on board with optimal weight for life.
For having me here. It's a pleasure to present today. So, like Ali said, I'm going to be talking about the Optimal Weight for Life program. So first I wanted to start off by showing a graph that depicts the obesity trends in the United States. So as you can see, two-thirds of adults in the U.S. are overweight, and one-third are obese. In 1991, 10 to 14% of the population was obese in most states. However, 13 years later, in 2004, 25% or more of the population is now obese. So as you can see, obesity keeps increasing. So obesity is also becoming a problem in children and adolescents. In fact, some even say that we have a childhood obesity epidemic. So childhood overweight and obesity mirrors somewhat adult obesity. A third of U.S. children and teens, about 25 million kids, are either overweight or at risk of overweight. So this is three times as many kids that are overweight now from the 1970s. So how do we determine if a person is overweight? So we calculate a person's body mass index. Have any of you heard of BMI before? Yeah. So in order to determine a person's body mass index, we calculate their weight in kilograms divided by their height in meters squared. So if your BMI falls between 25 to 29.9, you're classified as overweight. And if your BMI is 30 or more, you're classified as obese. So in children and adolescents, we still use the BMI to determine if they're underweight, at a healthy weight, or overweight, but since children and adolescents are growing, we need to plot their body mass index on growth charts. So if a child or adolescent falls on the 85th or over the 85th, they're considered overweight. And if they fall above the 95th percentile, if they plot above the 95th percentile, they're considered obese. This is just some examples of growth curves. You may have seen these before. I'm sure you all had them when you were younger. So on the left-hand side is plotting a child's weight and their height separately. And on the right-hand side is plotting their body mass index. So why do we care about childhood obesity? What's the big deal? Well, it's a very big deal. So there's a host of complications associated with childhood obesity. So this diagram shows all of those complications, so I won't talk about them all, but a few to highlight. So there's some psychosocial complications. So oftentimes, overweight or obese children may be depressed as a result of being overweight. They may have poor self-esteem compared to their other peers. Oftentimes, they'll have binge eating disorder. And binge eating disorder, or binge eating, I should say, is when you're eating a lot of food in a very short amount of time. Many of overweight children and adolescents have what's called sleep apnea. So that's when, throughout the night, a person stops breathing. So periodically throughout the night, you stop breathing, and then what happens is when you wake up, you don't feel refreshed. You end up feeling more tired, more exhausted, and less likely then to exercise, which can help control weight. There's gastrointestinal complications of being overweight. So we're now seeing children and adolescents with overweight children and adolescents with fatty liver disease. We never saw this in kids before. So fatty liver disease is more common in overweight adults and in adults who are alcoholics. They tend to have fat in their liver. Now we're seeing children with fat in their liver, and I'm currently working on a study comparing the effects of two different diets in children that have fatty liver disease, children and adolescents. So this is becoming a problem. We're seeing more type 2 diabetes. That used to be called adult onset disease. We can't call it that anymore, because now we're seeing children and adolescents with diabetes, type 2 diabetes. And actually, OWL has a type 2 diabetes clinic. With cardiovascular symptoms. So we see a lot of overweight children and adolescents that have high blood pressure, high cholesterol levels. So those are just to name a few. So what is causing this childhood obesity epidemic? Well, it's multifactorial. There's many components leading to childhood obesity. But one thing that in the last 30 years, our dietary patterns have changed. So for example, we're not eating meals in the home anymore. We're not having that, you know, mom's not cooking the home-cooked meal, and we're not sitting down at 6 o'clock at night for a family dinner. That doesn't happen so much anymore. It's less common. So more meals are being eaten at restaurants, fast food places, takeout. Our portion sizes have quadrupled in the last 30 years. So if you go to a restaurant, for example, a serving of pasta is 4 times what it should be. We have a lot of inexpensive processed foods. So, I mean, it's a lot cheaper to go to the convenience store and get a bag of chips than to buy fresh fruits and vegetables. And so as a result, we're eating less fruits and vegetables. There's been a huge increase in sugary beverages. So we're now consuming more calories in the form of sugar-sweetened beverages. Fewer families, like I mentioned, are eating together. So it's very common for the child to sit in front of the TV and eat versus eating at the dining room table. And then many adolescents, we find this is very common in clinic, they'll often skip breakfast altogether, and then they'll often graze, often in the evenings. So then what happens is they're eating till, you know, midnight or something like that, then they're less hungry in the morning to eat breakfast. So hence that vicious cycle of then skipping breakfast and having erratic eating patterns. So this graph, or this slide, is showing basically how much more fast food we're eating compared to the late 70s to, this is, you know, the mid-90s. Percentage of calories from fast food has markedly increased. Late 70s. Portion sizes have drastically increased, like I already mentioned. So between the 1950s and 1970s, there was 200 calories in a portion of fries. By 2000, 600 calories in a portion of fries. So there's 3 times as many calories in a portion of fries compared to between the 1950s and 1970s. Another example of the increase in portion sizes. Has anyone heard of the extreme gulp? Yeah, has anyone drank the extreme gulp? You want to guess how many calories are in it? 500 calories. So you guys all, being into physical activity, you'd have to run nearly 8 miles to burn the calories in that extreme gulp. I feel like doing that every day. A bagel from Dunkin' Donuts is equal to 4 slices of toast. So every time you have a bagel, you're eating 4 slices of toast. Popcorn. I was actually amazed a while ago. I went to the movie theaters and just wanted a diet soda, a small diet soda. It came like this big. And I was with my friend and I brought it back and she was like, we just wanted a small. I said, this was their small. So, I mean, portion sizes, it's just getting out of hand. So in 2004, that's 21 cups of popcorn. So that's almost 2,000 calories. You practically met your calorie needs in just the popcorn alone. So as I mentioned before, there's a lot more refined processed foods in our environment now. Emily is going to be talking more about that in just a little bit. But you know, we all think 100 calorie packs, fabulous, they're only 100 calories. But we have to think about the quality of those 100 calories. And they really don't have much substance to them. They're highly processed, refined, you know, a lot of packaged crackers and cookies and chips and white breads, sugary cereals. They contain little or no fiber. And you might even say maybe they're just food coloring with vitamins and minerals added. You know, some of those kids' cereals, I mean, they come in all different bright colors. So children and adolescents are eating not enough vegetables. And the vegetables they are eating is mainly in the form of French fries. It looks like adults are doing slightly better than children 2 to 19 years old. So some other factors. So I just talked about the changing dietary patterns that are promoting obesity. Now let's talk about some behavioral factors that are promoting obesity. Well, one thing for sure is that increased TV time. More kids are watching more TV, they're playing more video games, and then they're surfing the internet. They're on the computer hours and hours at a time. And especially with Instant Messenger and all of those things now, kids are just spending more and more time in front of a screen. And they're spending so less time physically active. So there's less exercise or even just play time. So kids used to come home from school and go outside and run around their backyard and play with their friends. They're not doing that anymore. They're coming home and watching TV or sitting in front of their computer. And then, like I mentioned before, there's more binge eating. So there's more consuming a lot of food in a very short amount of time. So this is just another graph showing how TV viewing has really increased since the 1960s. So almost half of children in the United States watch greater than 2 hours of TV a day. And this is just TV alone, so this isn't talking about computers or video games, so it's probably even more than that. Oh, and just as a note, so on this one, the American Academy of Pediatrics actually recommends no more than 2 hours of screen time a day for children and adolescents. So screen time does include TV, computer, video games, all of those things. So we have to talk about our environment, right? That's definitely a major cause of childhood or promoting obesity, childhood obesity. So our food industry markets, our food and beverage industry, markets a lot of unhealthy snacks and beverages to children and adolescents. So that's one major. So I'm going to show the next slide. I'm going to show you how they really, target. So the beverage and food industry targets children and adolescents in their marketing of products. Have you guys ever noticed if you go into a supermarket, the outer aisles, what types of foods do they have up? Like the sale items, the outer aisles, is it fruits and vegetables or what is it usually? Unhealthy foods, right? It's like the Cocoa Pebbles that's on sale for the week and that's at the end of the aisle. There's been a lot of reduced funding for physical education programs in schools. So a lot of schools have very tight budgets, and they've had to cut, unfortunately, their nutrition and their physical activity programs. Who here remembers home ec? Any of you guys have home ec in school? Yeah. A lot of schools don't even have home ec anymore. And for me, I just remember that's a time where I learned a lot of nutrition in home ec. I learned how to cook. I mean, a lot of children and adolescents are not learning how to cook, and then their parents don't know how to cook, so that leads to more going out to eat. And then this is more in the cities, there's a lack of safe and inexpensive recreational facilities for neighborhoods. So YMCAs are expensive. Gyms are expensive. There's not, unfortunately, especially in the inner cities, there's not a lot of safe parks and mountain areas for children to walk around, play. This is just an example of foods that are marketed to kids. So as you can see, Tony the Tiger, kids' vessels instead of pretzels, bug bites, graham crackers. So they use fun shapes, fun colors, fun packaging to attract kids, so they ask their parents to buy these products. And then there's other causes of obesity. There's biological causes of obesity that we can't not talk about, but they actually, very small percentage, so 5% or less of all cases of obesity is caused by a biological cause. But there certainly are some genetic diseases that cause, genetic factors that cause obesity, like Prader-Willi, some endocrine disorders that can cause obesity, hypothalamic. So, this is the sad news. Current medical treatment of obesity is largely unsuccessful. Subjects remaining in weight loss programs lose approximately 10% of their body weight. So, it's not a lot. It still is enough to reduce some of the complications of obesity, reduce your risk, but it's still not a lot. About 50% of weight loss is regained in 1 year. Almost all weight is regained by 5 years. So really, maintaining that weight loss, so once you lose the weight, maintaining it seems to be most difficult for people. And then if a child enters adolescence obese, they have only a 25% chance of achieving a normal weight later in life. So basically, we can't wait for a child to grow out of his or her obesity. We have to act now. And that leads me to the next slide, which is what we're here to talk about, is OWL. So OWL stands for Optimal Weight for Life, and it's a multidisciplinary care clinic, and it's dedicated to the evaluation and treatment of children who are overweight, children and adolescents who are overweight or obese. We also have, like I mentioned before, a type 2 diabetes clinic as part of one arm of OWL. It's the largest pediatric obesity clinic in New England, and it was started back in 1996 by Dr. David Ludwig. So I mentioned that it's a multidisciplinary team approach. So what does that mean? So it means that we have medical providers. So we have doctors and nurse practitioners. We have registered dietitians. We have psychologists. And we also have a social worker. And we also recently hired an intern who is our physical activity specialist. So when we have patients that, for example, lower income patients maybe that have difficulty implementing physical activity into their lifestyle, so we'll refer the patient to her and she'll work with them and determine what programs are available to them in their area, what physical activity programs are available in their area. We have an affiliation with the Boston YMCA, so we have discounts for families that really, if they want to go to the Boston, YMCA in the Boston area, we have some membership discounts to help lower income families. And then we also have an affiliation with Body by Brandy. Has anyone heard of her? No? Okay. She's in Roxbury, and she has probably one of first well-known kids' gyms, and so inner city, and it's free to most kids to go there, so they can go there, and she has like all sorts of fun gym equipment that's appropriate for kids and adolescents, and she's very enthusiastic and upbeat, and you know, she's just really passionate about what she does, so a lot of times we'll refer our children to Body by Brandy. And then we recently received a grant from New Balance. And we've decided to use $1 million grant. We've decided to use that money and really get into the community. So we're partnering with various community centers throughout the Boston area. And we're calling it OWL on the Road. And we're bringing our team to all these community centers. And we're talking about the OWL program. And we're teaching them what we do in OWL so then they can implement it in their community centers. Just a picture of the OWL team, the OWL nest as we like to call it. So who do we see in OWL? So we see patients ranging in age from 2 to 21. I've definitely seen several 2-year-olds, 3-year-olds. Oftentimes they have a BMI that's greater than the 95th percentile. And remember those BMI growth charts I showed you? Sometimes we can't even plot them on the chart. Sometimes they're off the chart. And you go to plot and then you realize, oh, you can't even plot them. They're no longer on the chart. Oftentimes the patients show up with something called acanthosis. And what it is, and I'm going to show you pictures in a second, it's dark lines usually across the neck or sometimes on the hands or the back of the neck or the stomach. And it's a sign of high insulin levels. So what it means is their body is probably producing too much insulin. And oftentimes, parents think it's their child just hasn't cleaned themselves well enough and just hasn't wiped the dirt off their neck. But it's actually something they can't scrub away. And in order to remove the dark lines, they have to lose weight. So weight loss is one of the keys to to removing some of those dark lines, the acanthosis. Oftentimes, like I mentioned before, our patients come in with high cholesterol levels, so high LDL, which is bad cholesterol, low HDL, which is your good cholesterol, high triglycerides, which sometimes is a symptom of having excessive carbohydrates in the diet. We also have elevated blood pressure. Some have high glucose levels, so they might have borderline high, meaning they're pre-diabetic. So they're at great risk for developing diabetes if, you know, we don't act now, we don't intervene now. Often they have, most of our patients have high insulin levels. And then, like I mentioned before, the sleep apnea. So usually the patients, they come in fasting, so we get blood draw, we take blood work, and we look at their lipid panel, their lipid profile, so what I just mentioned, we're looking at their cholesterol levels, we take a fasting glucose to make sure they're not pre-diabetic or diabetic, fasting insulin, hemoglobin A1C, so that's also another measure to determine if a person may be diabetic or not. We look at thyroid, some thyroid hormones, and then we also look at liver enzymes, so, and that may be an indicator of fatty liver disease. So usually they see the doctor and nurse practitioner first, and then they see the dietitian, and then usually the behavioral therapist last. Not always in that order, but that's the most common order. So during their medical evaluation, the doctor usually goes over why they're here. Some people honestly don't know. Some people, you know, the doctor, well, in all cases we need a doctor referral, but they don't even realize. We ask about any signs and symptoms, especially in terms of diabetes, so if they're having excessive thirst, things like that. Their past medical history, have they always been overweight? You know, is this from the time they were born, were they born a big baby, and then did they always clock high on the growth charts, or did they all of a sudden, did something happen and they rapidly gained a lot of weight recently? Their family history, their family medical history, so do they have a family history of type 2 diabetes? Should we be even more concerned? A family history of heart disease, cardiovascular disease. What's their social history? What's their family like? Siblings, do both parents have, you know, 2 full-time jobs and, you know, no one's home to cook the meals? Where do they go to school? How does the patient do in school? Are they affected by teasing, things like that? We ask, we go over a 24-hour recall. So actually the doctor and the dietitian both usually do a 24-hour recall. And then we talk about activities. You know, are they getting any physical activity? We explore that. And then the physical exam includes taking their weight, their height, plotting their BMI, their blood pressure, pulse, and then their overall general appearance. So for example, one thing would be to classify the acanthosis. So it's in different stages. So are they +1, +2, +3 would be the worst acanthosis. And this is a picture of acanthosis nigricans. Do you guys all see the dark lines on the neck? So that's an indicator of high insulin levels. This is oftentimes we see obese patients and they often have stretch marks. So stretch marks on our legs. Can you guys see? Striae, so purple marks. That's also a sign of, or that's a symptom of obesity. And so the last slide that I'm going to talk about before turning it over to Emily is, so I just talked about the medical component. Then they'll see behavioral medicine. And really, there's all sorts of psychosocial issues with overweight and obesity. So when they see the behavioral therapist or the social worker, they really work with the parents and the children, and it's really a team approach. And I forgot to mention that beforehand, is that we're not there just to treat the child or the patient. We're there to treat the whole family. Because if the family's not on board, then and they're the caregivers of the child, then the child is less likely to be successful. So we really need the whole family on board. And I'm going to talk more about that. But one of the things is protect, they talk about with the behavioral therapist, protecting the home environment. So what does that mean? So keeping the junk food out of the house. Okay, don't bring it in the house. Protect the home environment from the junk food, the unhealthy food. Be a good role model. So kids mimic their parents. So if a parent doesn't like fruits and vegetables, then their child is less likely to like fruits and vegetables. Or if their parent is unwilling to try new foods, then the child is going to be less willing to try new foods. So being, it's really important to being a be a positive role model for your children. For some reason in this day and age, we come across a lot of parents that don't have clear limit setting with their children. There's not a lot of discipline going on. So, you know, kids often can overstep their boundaries, and a lot of times parents use food as rewards this day and age. So you want to really define the boundaries and areas of responsibility between the parent and child. As a parent, it's your responsibility to say no to your children once in a while because it's for their health. And then working with the family and patients to develop coping strategies. Like I mentioned, a lot of people use food to cope. So what other strategies can we use besides food to help cope when things get really tough? And then we try to set realistic goals. So Emily's going to talk, like you said, about the dietary plan, and that's really like the gold standard. But if we have to meet the patient halfway, and you know, we really have to, I always say that I like them to like work with me to make the goals. I don't like to just tell them their goals. Because if I just tell them their goals, they're likely to take that piece of paper and throw it in the trash when they get home. Because it's me telling them. No one likes to be told what to do, but if they feel like we're working together and we're coming up with a plan that's real, reasonable, realistic for them, even if it's only just a few goals, that's great, you know? And then if they're able to accomplish that, they'll feel empowered then to make more changes the following time. That's it. Now I'm going to talk about our dietary evaluation. Everybody hear me?
So this is the part of this that Margaret and I would come in. We're both dietitians, so we're two of those five that she talked about. And so when we do our evaluation, there is a bit of overlap with the doctor. You know, we do find out about the history of the overweight. Some, you know, we try and talk to the doctor between visits to get as much information so the family doesn't have to repeat that much, but oftentimes there just isn't time for that because we do have a lot of clients coming in. We're a very busy clinic because this is a big problem. So we will talk to them about their history of their overweight. Do they have any history of dieting? You know, have they tried various popular diets that are you know, known today, such as the Atkins diet, or have they tried a low-fat diet, or what have they done with exercise prior to coming to our clinic? Have they seen any specialists before? And what have those specialists told them? What are their thoughts coming in? Do they eat meals together? You know, Margaret talked about a lot of our families are no longer eating their meals together. They're split up. Some people are in front of the TV, other people may be in another room on a computer. You know, but every once in a while, we do have a family come in that still does eat meals together as a family, which is great. Who does the grocery shopping and meal preparation? We really need to talk with this person. They are what we call the gatekeeper to the home. And so they're the ones who can be the ones who maintain that safe home food environment, and you know, and are the ones who can stop buying the junk food, or the ones who can still buy the junk food. And then where are their grocery store locations around them? Are they, you know, do they have to travel very far to get to a grocery store? Is it more convenient for them to go to a convenience store and shop? You know, because convenience stores don't have nearly as many healthy options. You aren't going to find the fruits and the vegetables there and the, you know, the whole grain crackers most of the time. You're going to be finding your chips and your Oreos and your really processed foods. And then we do a very in-depth 24-hour recall, sometimes usually more in-depth than what the doctor will do. You know, we inquire about boredom eating and binge eating and emotional eating, you know, trying to find out what are their struggle points throughout the day. A lot of times we have kids come in who will wake up in the middle of the night and go down at night and eat almost a full meal. And if you don't ask about that, they're generally not going to share that information with you. So you can be sure to cover all those questions. And then also assessing their motivation level. We have a few different ways that we do this. Sometimes we'll use scales, like on a scale of 0 to 10. How important is this to you? How confident are you that, you know, that you can make changes in your diet? Sometimes we don't go into that depth. Oftentimes it's just really assessing their body language. You know, in the way that they respond to your questions, how much information are they offering? Are they giving you one-word answers? Are they not even looking at you? And, you know, it takes a little bit of figuring out, are they just nervous, or do they really just not want to be there? So the dietary plan that we generally recommend is called the low glycemic index diet. Has anybody ever heard this term before? don't see any heads nodding.
Okay.
So the low glycemic index, I'm going to talk in depth about this in just a minute, but the basis of it is really low glycemic index carbohydrates, so I'm going to talk about what those are. And then on top of that, we want to include moderate amounts of lean protein and healthful fats. And then it's really about listening to internal hunger and fullness cues versus calorie counting. Because you know, our thoughts with eating a low glycemic index diet is that you're going to be able to tell whether or not you're full or whether or not you're hungry. And that's really what, you know, we believe that our bodies can tell us exactly how much to eat, okay, as long as you're eating the best choices. And then encouraging healthful snacks throughout the day. This is to really help control hunger and blood sugars. And so the more controlled your blood sugars are, the better controlled your hunger is, and the more controlled your eating is going to be. And then it's really about healthful eating for life. We're talking about a lifetime change, not just a change for the next year, you know, where they may get down to the most healthful weight for their body, but then if they revert back to their old eating habits, it's not going to have done any long-term good. So we're really working with them on implementing lifetime changes, which is part of the reason why we want to set realistic goals for them, because we want this to be something that's going to become a habit for them. You know, if they change everything all at once, a lot of times it's much more difficult to maintain those changes. A low GI diet is very different to what is traditionally recommended. Typically, what people would recommend for weight loss would be a low-fat diet. Has anybody here in this room ever tried to follow a low-fat diet before? I know I have in the past. And so what we found is that low-fat diets are not very satisfying. Usually people feel deprived of foods, and they often feel very hungry. But what we're finding with the low GI diet is that it really prevents excess hunger, because your appetite is greatly influenced by your blood sugars. And the low GI diet is all about controlling your blood sugars. So if your blood sugars are going up and down all day, you're actually going to be more hungry throughout the day, which is often what we find with a low-fat diet, versus if they're more well-controlled, with, you know, kind of even keel ups and downs, you aren't going to be as hungry throughout the day. So you're more satisfied. And ad libitum, as I mentioned, is not calorie controlled. And we really want them to listen to their internal hunger and fullness cues. So what exactly is the glycemic index? This is a method of classifying carbohydrate-containing foods, and it was proposed in the 1980s by a man named Jenkins, and he was really a pioneer in this field. And because what had happened was, we found out in the 1980s or so that the way that we were classifying carbohydrates was completely inaccurate. And so we needed a better system. Really, the goal was to help diabetics in their meal plans and coming up with appropriate meal plans. And so this guy Jenkins developed the glycemic index, and it's really looking at the effect of carbohydrate-containing foods on blood sugar. And each food is tested by a person eating it, and then blood sugars are measured, and they usually test lots of people and then average the results. And it gets assigned a glycemic index value. And the value is based on how quickly or slowly that food broke down and it affected that person's blood sugars. So this is the numbers that we use. Low glycemic index would be considered 50 or less, moderate 51 to 69. So a low would be like a non-starchy vegetable, like broccoli would be considered a non-starchy vegetable, or green beans. A moderate glycemic index would be like your like a stone ground bread or whole grain bread would be considered moderate. A high glycemic index would be those processed foods that Margaret was talking about, you know, the Oreos and the chips or the white bread. Now, the thing about glycemic index is that it doesn't account for typical serving size. So when they measure a glycemic index of the food, they'll take 50 grams of carbohydrate for that food. So for example, you can see here with carrots that 50 grams of carbohydrate is not a typical serving. Usually if someone's eating carrots, they're only eating 5 grams of carbohydrate. So what was developed was something called the glycemic load, which helps you understand the effect on blood sugar for a typical serving size. And so if you look at, we have this calculation that we do, and we're using the available carbohydrate, and then what we come up with is another number. So going back to this chart, you can see that for carrots, the glycemic load was 2.4, which is quite low for the glycemic load. So that's a very helpful food that does not affect your blood sugars a lot. So how do we practically use the glycemic index? We don't talk numbers with our patients. We don't go up to them and say, well, the glycemic index of this food is 55, so that's actually a moderate glycemic. You know, we don't do any of that. What we do talk about is how quickly foods are broken down. So we'll explain to them that all carbohydrate-containing foods are broken down into sugar. And that doesn't matter if it's coming from grains, fruits, broccoli, you know, vegetables, beans, or dairy foods. All those foods have carbohydrate that break down into sugar. But the difference is that some foods break down more quickly than others. And that's what we call high glycemic index carbohydrates. And these are foods that are broken down very quickly. They cause a rapid rise and fall in blood sugar. So some examples, as I mentioned before, are the more processed foods. Your refined pretzels, your sugary cereals like Frosted Flakes and Fruit Loops, your white bagels, your white bread. Most of the packaged snacks that are marketed to our children are very high glycemic index foods. Starchy vegetables such as potatoes and corn actually fall into this category as well as certain fruits. So pineapple and watermelon tend to have higher glycemic indexes. This is just a graph of a glycemic response between two different grains, essentially. So the red line is white bread and the green line is pasta. Can someone give me some information, like what do you see on this chart? I really want someone to answer. Yeah.
The pasta and the green, it's just a little bit more, it's spread out even more evenly than the rest.
Right, exactly. So if you see this pasta, it doesn't go up nearly as high as the white bread. So that means that it's not breaking down as quickly in the stomach. And then look at this point, about an hour and a half later, what happens with this white bread? What happens to the blood sugar? It drops, exactly, and look, it's dropping. So granted, zero is not necessarily, you know, we don't have zero blood sugars, but consider zero baseline. Like, so your blood sugar is dropping below normal when you eat that white bread. Has anybody ever had low blood sugars before or think they might have felt that before? Yeah, what are some of the symptoms of low blood sugar?
Shaky.
Uh-huh, yeah. Anything else?
Tired.
What about hungry? Do you simply feel hungry when you have low blood sugars? Yeah, I think I do, and I think that, you know, a lot of our patients experience that. So it tends to be extreme hunger, because your body, its goal is to get your blood sugars back up. It knows that that's going to happen if you eat carbohydrate-containing foods. So if you eat something and you start, you know, this high rapid rise and fall in blood sugar, you're probably going to be reaching for the same foods, because your body wants your blood sugar to go up quickly again, because it's not comfortable with where its blood sugar is at. And that's sadly what leads to a lot of overeating. You know, if you're extremely hungry, you're probably gonna be eating a lot of food because you can't think about what you're eating as easily. So some of the effects of high glycemic index carbohydrates, like I was just talking about, are the extreme hunger, which leads to overeating and weight gain. Fatigue, as you had mentioned, difficulty concentrating is something that we find, especially with kids, which is why we talk about one of the things I'll talk about is having a balanced breakfast. A lot of kids don't do as well in school. And then our term for when the blood sugars go up and down all day, we call it the blood sugar roller coaster. That kind of helps kids relate to that a little bit better with that terminology. So as you say, not all carbs are created equal, and there's the other side of the spectrum, which are low glycemic index carbohydrates. And these are what have that gradual rise and fall in blood sugar. These are your fruits and non-starchy vegetables, your beans, so your black beans, your kidney beans, not your green beans. I mean, your green beans do count, but legumes are your black beans, the kidney beans, and things like that. And then your unsweetened dairy, so your plain milk, your plain yogurt or light yogurt. With fruits, I did want to mention that a very general rule with fruits is that if it has an edible skin, it has a lower glycemic index. So, you know, your apples, your pears, your peaches, versus your bananas and watermelon and pineapple. So you can't see the title of this slide, but it says, what about grains? So where do grains fall in the spectrum? Are they high? Are they low? Well, actually, grains are what we call moderate. They're in the middle. There's really no grains with a low glycemic index because grains are mostly carbohydrate. And so what you want to look for are true whole grains. So has anybody ever heard of the white whole wheat? The white whole wheat bread, the Wonder White Whole Wheat? So that's a better choice than white bread, but it's not actually a true whole grain. First, it's been processed, and then it's had some fiber added back to it. What we really want is a grain that's been less processed. So some words you can look for are 100% whole wheat. If you see that on the front of the package, you know that that's a true whole grain. Stone ground breads tend to be most true whole grains, or sprouted breads. I don't know if anyone's ever seen those before. A good general rule is to look for 3 grams of fiber or more per serving. So if you're running through the grocery store and you look like you're trying to read the ingredient list, if you pick up a bread and you notice it has, you know, 3 or 4 grams of fiber, you're probably doing okay. That's not a 100% guarantee, but it's probably a good choice. With cereals, though, it's important to have 4 grams of fiber or more, because those tend to have a bit more sugar, so you need more fiber to kind of offset that. And then just some examples of moderate glycemic index bread crackers and cereals. If anyone's ever heard of Achmat crackers or Triscuits, actually are moderate. Ezekiel bread, and also Kashi Goulaine cereal. Those are just some examples that are on the market today. So this is what a true whole grain looks like. A true whole grain has 3 components to it. So it has what we call the bran, and this is where all the fiber is found. It has what we call the germ, and this is where the majority of the vitamins and minerals are found. And then the endosperm, this is where all the starch is found. So your starch is your carbohydrate. And what they do when they make refined breads is they strip away this bran, so they take away all the fiber, they strip away this germ, so they're taking away all the natural vitamins and minerals, and they leave you with this endosperm, so all the starch. And when they create bread out of that, it has that nice, you know, spongy, springy texture, kind of the traditional Wonder Bread. Has anyone ever eaten? I've had bread like that before, you know, but most people like that nice spongy texture versus if you have a whole grain bread, it's not quite as soft when you eat it. Some other moderate glycemic index grains do include rice, pasta, and other grains that are on the market. With rice, it's generally ground rice or basmati rice. Pasta is a moderate glycemic index grain. It has a higher protein content. However, you need to be cautious to cook pasta al dente. So that means a little bit on the firmer side. When you cook pasta longer, it breaks down much quicker in your stomach. Quinoa, barley, I don't know if anyone's ever eaten those before, and also steel-cut oatmeal versus even old-fashioned oatmeal. Steel-cut breaks down much less quickly. Now, with glycemic index, it's not the end-all be-all, okay? There are other things to consider. So one is portion size. If you have 4 slices of bread at one time, you're gonna have a higher spike in your blood sugars than if you just had 1 or 2 slices of bread. And also combination meals and snacks. So what I mean by that is including some protein and some helpful fats in with your meal. And what protein and fat do is they can't be broken down as quickly in your stomach, so they end up slowing down the digestion of everything else that you eat along with them. So for example, I think I have some examples here. With a meal, it might be your chicken, which is your protein, and then you have some al dente pasta, so there's your grain and your broccoli, you're getting in some non-starchy vegetables, and then some cheese, you've got some fat and some protein in there. You know, snacks, you have your apple and your peanut butter is your protein and your fat. Whole grain crackers with cheese, the cheese again is your protein and your fat, or the yogurt, you know, you're getting some protein there with fruit and nuts, and nuts again being protein and fat. So eating these things together reduce the overall effect on your blood sugars and create a more satisfying snack so that you don't get hungry as soon. This is the pyramid that we use in our clinic, and as you can notice, grains are actually on the second level. And on the bottom, which make up the majority of our diet, are the most fruits, non-starchy vegetables, and beans. And then secondary would be your 100% whole grains, some healthy fats, here's your protein level, and then up here, the least things that in our diet would be, you know, the starchy vegetables, the refined grains, the processed snack foods, your desserts, those would all be kept to a minimum in your diet. So what we find with kids is that sometimes the easiest way for them to understand this is for us to just give them a picture of what their dinner plate could look like, so that they can just look down and say, okay, great, I'm doing a good job eating a low glycemic, you know, eating the way that my dietitian told me to. And we encourage them to have half of their plate covered with non-starchy vegetables. And those can be raw, they can be cooked, it doesn't really matter. With a quarter of lean protein is the king of wholeness, so that's a really important thing to have, and then a quarter of their plate covered by 100% whole grains or their starchy vegetables, whatever they prefer, but not both together. And if they can make their plate look like this, then they're really eating in a low glycemic way, in a way that's going to control your hunger and blood sugars. So some of the beverage recommendations, as Margaret said, the intake of sugar-sweetened beverages has jumped massively over the past couple decades. And so if that's almost one of the first things that we recommend. A lot of times, I'll see kids coming in who are drinking easily a liter of multiple sugar-sweetened beverages a day, maybe a mixture of juice, soda, Capri Sun, Sunny D, things like that. And that's the easiest thing for them usually to initially cut out and just switch to sugar-free drinks. The problem with sugar-sweetened beverages is that when we drink them, we don't compensate for those calories. We will actually eat the same amount of calories in food generally that we would have even if we didn't drink these sugar-sweetened beverages. So they tend to be calories on top of whatever food we eat that day. Does anybody have a guess as to how many teaspoons of sugar are in a 20-ounce bottle of Coke?
42.
That would be grams of sugar. How many? No, but that was good. Good. So, there's about 18 teaspoons of sugar in one bottle of Coke. So those, you know, the little sugar packets that you get at like Dunkin' Donuts or whatever, there's 18 of those in one bottle of Coke. And we have some kids coming in drinking, you know, three of these a day, and they don't even realize. Generally, juice, you know, parents tend to say, well, drink juice. Juice is good for you. But actually, juice is considered a sugary beverage. And you want to limit juice to no more than half a cup per day, which is about 4 ounces, and that's consistent with the American Academy of Pediatrics recommendations. And so instead of drinking these sugary beverages, we recommend plain water, first and foremost, which is always the most important thing for just, you know, rehydrating yourself. Plain milk, there are a lot of flavored waters on the market now that are sugar-free, or diet soda on occasion. This is just an example of a marketing tool that that the food industry uses. And the thing about it is that one small cup of orange juice, so say a 12-ounce cup of orange juice, if you drank that every day and it was above your calorie needs, you would put on 15 pounds in 1 year. And that's just with orange juice, and that's only one 12-ounce cup a day. So again, why do we want to select low glycemic and low glycemic loaded foods? For the regulation of hunger and satiety, it's going to make you much more in tune with your hunger and fullness cues internally. It's going to help prevent overweight and obesity, which is something that we're proving in our clinic. We're seeing kids make huge differences in, you know, with their weight and reaching much healthier weights and getting rid of some of their high cholesterol and high blood pressure. There's a very large growing body of evidence that supports that reduced and low glycemic index diets are very effective in lowering the risk for diabetes and lowering the risk for heart disease and for cancers, you know, colon cancer and breast cancer, I believe. Like, you can dramatically lower your risk of developing these things. So what are our weight loss goals when we're counseling our patients in clinic? For kids, you have to be very careful about recommending weight loss. It's because they're still growing, and they still need to get a certain amount of nutrients. They're going to grow taller, and you know, BMI is a measure of your weight to your height. So if kids maintain their weight and they grow taller, they're going to grow right into a healthier weight. So when do we recommend weight loss? With children 2 to 7 years old, we recommend weight loss if they're greater than the 95th percentile and they have some type of complications. Maybe they high insulin levels or hypertension. And then if they do have those things, we recommend only a loss of 1 pound per month until they reach closer to the 85th percentile, and then what we want them to maintain. With children 7 years or older, they're almost always above the 95th percentile. It's very rare for us to have a child come into clinic who's below the 95th percentile, so we generally do recommend a slow rate of weight loss. But I think that our focus is always, first and foremost, on a healthy diet versus weight loss. And that gets back to what Margaret was talking about, with parenting styles, and I'm actually going to be talking about as well right here, is that we really want to focus on health rather than weight. We don't want these kids to get so focused on their weight and get down on themselves if they go up, because if they have a great, spurt in their height, they may actually put on a pound or two, and it would be okay, their BMI may still come down. We really want parents to have healthy snacks ready available. The parent's job is really to control the foods that come into the home, and then it's the child's job to eat those foods. So if the parents have the healthy snacks available, then the child can eat those when they're hungry. We want them to watch portion sizes, so modeling appropriate portion sizes, serving appropriate portion sizes, keeping juice and soda out of the house, and turning off the TV, eating as a family, not eating while you're watching TV. Encouraging participation in other sports, in other activities, getting them out of the house so they aren't always watching TV all the time. And also being a positive role model. Again, Margaret talked about this, but it's very important for the parents to do this together with their children. It's not nearly as effective if they aren't willing to do this as a family. Things to discourage. We don't necessarily want them banning particular foods. A lot of times what will happen is that child will just become so focused on that food that's all that they think about. We want them to be able to have treats. Just go out for treats. Don't bring the treats into the home. Allow food decisions to be made by kids. Again, that's the child's decision, is when to eat, how much to eat. We want them to learn to pay attention to their internal hunger and fullness cues. And so we don't want them to necessarily clean their plate. If they're full, it should be okay for them to stop. Don't stress diet or weight over healthy eating habits. And don't keep large amounts of junk food in the house. We need to maintain that safe home food environment. We really don't want a TV in the bedroom. All that does is encourage more TV watching, more sedentary activities. Some of the things that we assess when we're counseling our patient, again, as I mentioned, are their motivation level. It's very important for us to understand the level of family support and involvement. A lot of times the mom, maybe she's a single mom and she's working a job, and so she has other family members or other caretakers taking care of their kids. A lot of times if the child is in daycare, the mom comes in and says, "I don't even know what he eats at daycare. I have no clue." Those are important things for us to find out. We stress the fact that we need to understand obesity as a chronic disease. A lot of parents come in and don't understand that obesity really is a disease, and we need to treat it like a disease, and that should be okay. And socioeconomic status, what are their struggles? Are they financially struggled? Do they even have neighborhoods where they can go walk and play and run? Do they have a backyard or someplace safe to be? And also cultural factors. So sometimes it's not culturally okay to eat a healthful diet. And also culturally, a different body type may be preferred over another. And we need to understand where that family is coming from so that we can work with them. I did want to mention here too, something that the OWL Clinic does to assist people based on their socioeconomic status is we will give out gift cards to help people purchase helpful foods, fruits and vegetables or more whole grains. And we even have funds, especially since we got this New Balance grant, that we can help kids purchase sneakers if they don't have money to buy sneakers, or sometimes even give kids a bike. Things like that are going to get them more likely to be outside and make it easier for them to live a healthful lifestyle. So one of the last things that we wanted to do was just give you an example of what a dietary recall might look like of a child that comes into clinic. This is not a fake, this is a very realistic dietary recall, something that we might see. And so I'd like all for everyone to kind of go over this with me, and then I'm going to ask their opinions. What are some things that we can change here? So in the morning, we have two cups of Fruit Loops. Let's say that this is an eight-year-old child, okay? So we have two cups of Fruit Loops, 1% milk, and 16 ounces of apple juice. Their snack would be a 100-calorie pack. Lunch, they eat school lunch, maybe they get free school lunch, and so school lunch is generally, you know, chicken nuggets and french fries. The child chooses chocolate milk to drink, and then there's a dessert served every day, and this day they had a cookie. Their after-school snack, they come home, they have some canned fruit, it's canned in syrup, and maybe their mom bought them a special vitamin water to drink. Dinner, they have 6 ounces of chicken breast with a cup of mashed potatoes, a cup of corn, and a 12-ounce can of Coke to drink. And then their dessert after dinner would be 1.5 cups of Chunky Monkey ice cream. So, does anybody have any suggestions? Like, where would you start? What are some general recommendations that someone might think would be okay to make? Yes?
For breakfast, you wouldn't have 2 cups of cereal. You'd probably just have one, and maybe a cereal that has whole grains. And instead of the 1% milk, maybe skim milk, and then either 4 ounces of orange juice or water.
Yeah, yep, great recommendations, definitely. So portion size is something that you key in on. You really need to watch the portion size. You want a more satisfying breakfast, so that Fruit Loops, what's gonna happen to their blood sugar? It's gonna spike and then it's gonna drop, especially with that juice. So, those are all really great points. Anyone else have any suggestions? But any other meals of the day or?
Yeah, get rid of the Coke and the vitamin water for snacks and dinner.
Yeah, definitely. What else could we recommend for them to eat?
Or drink? Water and milk.
Yeah, water and milk, exactly. this child doesn't have a lot of calcium in their diet, so having a glass of milk with dinner would be a much better choice, and then, you know, choosing plain milk at lunch, and then maybe having water at dinner, you know, one or the other. That's a great recommendation. That's going to get rid of a lot of calories and sugar in one very easy change. That's something that we probably would start with if we were in clinic with this child. That'd be the first thing that we would hone in on. Anyone else? Yeah.
Change the first snack with the 100-calorie pack of oil.
Yeah, any idea what you think might be a good snack?
Maybe yogurt with fruit or something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. Having a little bit of yogurt with fruit, so it still gives them some sweetness, you know, but it's going to be much more satisfying. And if someone else had a hand up over here? Yeah.
Maybe.
One then the other.
Maybe switching one of the things for dinner, like a cup of mashed potatoes or a cup of corn to something else rather than have two starchy vegetables?
Exactly, yeah, you just said a key word. There are two starchy vegetables there, and those are actually large portions of each starchy vegetable, especially for an 8 or 9 year old. So we would recommend sticking with only half a cup of a starchy vegetable, and then what could you serve instead of either the corn or the mashed potatoes? What would be a good substitute?
Broccoli.
Yep, broccoli or green beans or carrots, you know, whatever the child likes. You want to get them eating those vegetables that they like, but also trying new things. Great, those are some excellent points. I just had put basically the same things that you guys have recommended here, switching to a higher fiber, lower sugar cereal. So in general, our recommendations are looking for at least 4 grams of fiber and less than 8 grams of sugar. And there are many cereals on the market that are meeting this recommendation now, and there are more coming out very frequently. Limiting the juice, as we talked about, and then also choosing fresh fruit over canned. The more processed a food is, the more quickly it's going to break down in your stomach. And then also there was sugar, and you know it was in a syrup, so fresh fruit is always going to be a better choice. Eating balanced snacks, we talked about the yogurt, adding some fruit in, apple with peanut butter, maybe a handful of nuts with dried fruit. Packing lunch, if there's any way that we can do that. That would probably, you know, depending on the socioeconomic status of the family, that may be something that we try and work on in advance, or maybe something that we put off for a while. But if they did pack lunch, it would be, you know, basically consisting of this, and then limiting the starchy vegetables, as we talked about, and then limiting dessert to once per day and sticking to a small portion size. And that was everything.
Thank you, two ladies, for being here this morning and making this fine presentation. Our time's limited in terms of, usually there's time to ask questions to.
Sorry.
That's fine. We maxed you out, which is critical too. But I just have one question I'd like to follow up with. I in terms terms of your overall presentation, your suggestion was a loss of 1 pound a month. The population out there generally thinks of losing weight of maybe a pound or two a week, and maybe even that's not what they would like to lose. They'd like to lose a lot faster. So, but I guess what you're really presenting here is a lifestyle change.
Exactly.
And that lifestyle change will eventually equate to weight loss over a greater period of time and be much more beneficial in terms of their adult life.
Right.
I think
exactly.
That's where you're coming from.
And I think that what we're finding with what Margaret had talked about with people who tend to lose weight and then put it on within the next year or up to 5 years, that's usually people who are losing weight fairly quickly as well. And we find that if we can, if they're losing weight more slowly, it's generally because they're making smaller changes, but those changes are going to be more likely to stick. And so that's our recommendation, really, for anyone who's trying to lose weight, is pick one or two things and really focus on them, make them a habit, and then proceed forward in small steps. And that's totally okay to do, but it's hard because we're such an instantaneous society. We want to see very fast results, and that's really not the way that it's going to last for a lifetime, which is the overall goal.
And children, too, like Emily mentioned, they're growing.
Yeah.
So the weight loss is going to be slower because they're also going to be growing.
Right.
Versus adults, the recommendation may be 1 or 2 pounds per week.
But still, the emphasis greater on the lifestyle change.
Exactly.
Look, again, time being critical here, I'm not trying to